Right. It is day 4 of 11 of PAX East 2019. I got in yesterday to set up, and I was like, okay, and, wait, there's 4 days. Shit. For those that don't know, this is the improvised post-mortem. The basic premise is actual post-mortems are informative, are educational. They tell you what went right and what went wrong with certain games. Am I echoing a lot? Sounds like I don't know. Okay, well, we'll try it over here. But what if you had to do a post-mortem and you didn't know the name of the video game you're about to talk about because it's made up and I made it up? So I asked my friends who are games journalists and comedians and the head of a game studio to do the show, and we're just gonna have fun with it. That's the first half. They're gonna come up one at a time. I'm gonna give them the name of a fake video game. They're gonna talk about it for a bit. Then the second half is the lightning round. And it's not scary. It's just, I took a bunch of...
I was a little scared. I get shocked easy, especially in carpeted rooms.
Look, someone gasped out there, I'm just saying. I asked Twitter to tell me a bunch of fake video game names, and then we're gonna go through a bunch of them, and I'm gonna make people team up, and it'll be fast, a la the lightning round. Anyway, I'm gonna give you an example. I'm just gonna talk off the cuff. I know the name of this game, I'm cheating. But also, I wanted to say it because folks that know this panel, most of you that tweeted me ideas for fake video game names really wanted to make fun of Windjammers. And not because you don't love Windjammers, it's because one time somebody said that we were never gonna get another Windjammers.
Pat, who was that?
It was some very, very nice man.
I would like to point out it's technically still correct. Oh. You've had the same Windjammers again. They've announced a new Windjammers. Is it gonna come out?
That's fair. Windjammers 2 technically does not exist yet because we can't play it yet.
I played it.
I didn't make Windjammers 2. I made Windjammers 3.5. Ooh. I know, right? It's a stopgap between Windjammers 3, which does not exist, and Windjammers 4, which does not exist. But in my mind, if you just kind of like up the graphics on Windjammers 3, that's Windjammers 3.5. It's for modern 8K televisions, which also maybe don't exist, but maybe do. It has all of the wind and all of the jamming you want from Windjammers, but it's also, we got rid of the beach. We thought that was actually the thing great. We love the frisbee elements of Windjammers. And by we, I mean the company that I own and I am the sole employee of. We love the wind. We love...
the jamming.
Disking. The jamming, yes. We hate the beach. We think that Windjammers 3.5 will take place indoors. It'll have a roof. It'll look like a high school gymnasium. The power-ups are gone. The power moves are gone. We're bringing it back to the basics, which is throwing a disc and looking vaguely European while doing so. Are there giant sunglasses? Of course. We understand what you want in a Windjammers 3.5. If we didn't put... okay, so we tried not to put sunglasses in the game, and people that played the alpha got very mad about it, and I got death threats. So now there are... so now there are sunglasses. Please leave my family alone. And it's just that simple. That's all that this is. Yeah, right? You don't have to, but I like it. You don't have to applaud there, but it makes me feel good.
Give it up for Pat Bear, everybody!
Okay. So when I started doing this panel, I said that I would time the beginnings, but that's not true. We just go off the vibe. So Speaking first, let's have Abby Russell come up to the podium.
Thank you. Hello. You are far away. Should I be right up on it?
What?
No, that's okay.
Okay, Abby, I would love for you to tell everybody about your game, The Sims Battle Royale.
Okay, so this game is very bloody right off the bat, and people friggin' loved it. So the key to The Sims Battle Royale, it is a battle royale, as we all know. It is a Sims game, as we all know. But the real fun gets in once you get in on the expansion packs. Heyo! Yes. So I am super rich from them, and you're having so much fun from them. We have the family expansion pack, where it's families versus families. We, of course, have pets. It's dog fighting. You know, you gotta have vampires, which is just a bunch of hot teens making out. I love The Sims. I love Battle Royales. One of my favorite features in this game is the character creator. I let you go in and pick all of your battle scars. That's right, you go in with battle scars because it's assumed that all your Sims have already won a Battle Royale going in, so they are veterans. So it's 100 Sims who really know how to fucking kill. Can I swear on this?
Yeah.
Okay. So, I love this game, and you guys helped make it number one on the game charts. Metacritic, mwah. Steam, mwah. Epic Game Store, mwah, mwah, mwah. We love The Sims, I love The Sims, and we're getting more DLC right to you. Thank you.
All right, thank you, Abby. Thank you very much, Abby, for that fantastic game, Sims Battle Royale, available on all platforms.
Every single one except for the EA store.
Yeah. Not on that one. No, it's for the money. Okay, let's welcome Dave Lang.
Yeah.
Dave, we would love to hear.
Before you get into that, I would just like to be clear that I'm the one that owns my own game studio. I thought it was weird. They seem curious.
Yeah. Dave, we'd love to hear about your game.
Are you both
Sugar Boy Jones? And Candy Girl's epic experience?
Yes.
Well, obviously, it's launching exclusively on the Epic Games PC store. Right out the gates, let's handle the business case first. They're just cutting checks left, right, and center. You'd be an idiot not to do it. I mean, sure, the people that played, you know, the spiritual successor to this game, Sugar Boy and Candy Girl, they're a little PO'd. They're expecting it to show up on Steam. They're expecting it to show up on the Windows 10 store. For some reason, it's unclear to me. but fuck them. Because guess what? Guess how much Candy Boy and the Sugar Boy? I know my game. I know what it's called. Sugar Boy and the Candy Girl, the original one, it sold about 300,000 copies. Which sounds like a lot, but it's not a number, which means we made $0. It's got an I next to it for the math majors in the room. Thank you very much for laughing at that. I appreciate it. All right, let's talk about the game for a minute. That'd probably be helpful. So, Sugar Boy, there's a spoiler alert, everyone. We were all sad when he melted when it rained in the first one. We were all really sad. Candy Girl's epic experience in this one is reconstituting Sugar Boy from the muck and the earth and the dissolved sugar resin. I think resin's a word. She scoops up, it starts literally where Sugar Boy and Candy Girl ended. This fucking game starts. You're going on a journey with me right now because we're designing the game on the fly. It starts like she's on the cutscene where she's taking a knee like Kaepernick, except it's not about justice, it's about saving Sugar Boy. She takes Sugar Boy, she scoops all that stuff in the floor into a bag. She's like, I hope I got all of Sugar Boy in this dirt and earth that he just melted into, my best friend Sugar Boy. And she goes, she's trying to get to a place where it would make sense, where you could reconstitute a Sugar Boy. I can't think of Domino Sugar Factory in Baltimore. Which, lucky for her, just in a suburb of Baltimore. So that's where that last game ended. Very weird. which made for not a very good game. because I have Epic in here, which I thought would be sure to get money from the Epic store. That part worked. They're just giving money to anybody, literally anybody, and I know because I'm a video game executive.
All right, thank you, Dave. Thank you very much, Dave. There's a callback. At a certain point in there, I think Dave zoned out and was just pitching a game. Just at a certain point, he was like, yeah, this is what I do. Let's make this game. He got into it. All right.
It's just Sour Patch Kids 2, right?
Let's talk to Casey Malone.
Yeah.
Casey. Casey. Thank you. Casey, the folks at home on Twitch, the folks here in the audience live, they'd love to hear about your video game. Who's that over there?
There's an adage in video game development right now, which is that you never want to make the second best game on the market in your genre. And with Who's That Over There, we think we've finally ID'd everyone possible and climbed to the top of the pile. You point our game at literally anyone, and it will tell you who's over there. Right there? Jeff. Different Jeff. And I think the key to our game's success is that we were able to monetize this in a way that really resonated with players, because what would happen is you'd point at someone and be like, oh, we'll tell you who that is, 99 cents. You do it, you pay us your dollar, and you find out who it is. It's a pretty simple game when you break it down. There were a few problems in development. First of all, we were using biometrics and invading basically everyone's privacy, which was a downer for players, but really did well with venture capitalists. They were very into that. We were able to take all the funding we got for that game. We're working on a sequel that we think will be very successful, which is What Is That Sandwich? Point the camera at any sandwich, tell you what's in it. It's usually ham. We have a problem with the algorithm right now. It tends to think any kind of pork is ham. So if you're eating like a smashed pork loin sandwich or like a pulled pork sandwich, it's just like ham. So we're working on the bugs, but we're in alpha. Pre-register at sandwichid.com, and we're hoping to launch in Q3 this year. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Casey is a comedian and also a game designer, and then just pitched us a terrifying app. No.
TM.
All right. So we're gonna jump in. Laser.
Yes.
Laser Melinda Weber. Laser, you're a comedian, a podcaster,
yes.
a director, a musician.
Correct.
You also made a video game.
Yes, I did.
And we would love to hear more about having a pizza party.
Ooh. Thank you. I know I don't have to really tell you about what having a pizza party is, and I would like to spend most of my time addressing the things that you believe I have to apologize for. When I first came up with the concept for having a pizza party after eating a lot of pizza and then sleeping, I knew it would be an instant success. It's World of Warcraft, where all of the characters are pizza, and all of the monsters are pizza, and all of the environmental elements are also pizza. The thing is that people like World of Warcraft, and they like pizza even more than that. The thing that was wrong is that almost everybody I asked to work on the game after it came out wanted to be paid. Mm. Mm. I have regrets about not seeing that coming, but we're addressing those issues by individually having those people go to our players' houses and ask them for money instead of me. Players each paid $29.95 for the game,
It also came with a pizza. The rest of the money bought me a big house that looks like a pizza. I guess I would say if I have one regret, it would be not thinking of toppings that weren't pepperoni, because I think that would have really diversified the color palette of the game. And the DLC, is that what you're saying? Yeah. The DLC is pineapple, and I know. And this is why I can't go into public anymore. Anyway, please get the game. It's coming out on Switch tomorrow. Thank you.
Yeah. All right, thank you so much for that laser. Fucking pineapple, come on, guys. All right, for the first part of this show, we're gonna close off by hearing from Mr. Jeff Gerstmann. We're so thrilled to hear about your most recent game, Rude People versus Capcom.
Thanks everyone for coming to my micro talk. I'm pretty excited to really break down Rude People versus Capcom. We learned a lot on this project. And it did really well on the balance sheet. I mean, not to just start with business, but let's start with business. We were all set. We were basically days away from signing our deal with Epic, which would have guaranteed the game would have broken even, and no matter what. And that was pretty exciting. And then Google came along, and they were like, hey, we need stuff. And so they basically beat Epic, like, 8x. So we signed with them, and it was very exciting because, like, they were like, oh, you're gonna be able to do things with games you've never seen before, the stream, the power of the cloud. And, like, I was thinking, you know, as designer, I was like, this is great because there are a lot of Rude People that we were unable to include because just, you know, modern consoles just can't hold that many Rude People. And thankfully, the power of the cloud is nearly infinite, and we were able to basically include every single Rude person that I'm aware of. And so as a result, I am gonna announce here that, you know, with our upcoming patch, we are changing the name of the game to Rude People versus Capcom Infinite. We just figured it just had a good ring to it. And we learned a lot, as I said. You know, having never really made a fighting game before, we really didn't want to make one here. But we couldn't really think of anything else, so it just kind of became a fighting game. We thought we would maybe kind of undercut some of the other kind of approachable fighting games on the market by just one button. And so we built controllers around one single button that was just marked Rude. And if you picked a Rude person, you needed to hit the button. If you picked Capcom, which actually, it was just the car from Speed Rumbler, and the dude from Trojan. And if you picked either of them, you just, like, and then the power of the cloud would, you know, basically kind of fill in the blanks, I guess. I don't know. It seems like that's just how you do games now. It turns out that people really wanted different Capcom characters, and a lot of people tried to sue us once they discovered they were in the game, which, frankly, I think is very rude. So we're hoping to get some seed money to, you know, get another game going here. Google has basically said that we were going to be the first game to go when they shut down the service in about 6 months. So get in while you can, and stay rude.
All right. Thank you so much, Jeff. We really thought it would last. No, we didn't. All right, it's time for the lightning round. Now, originally I thought, let's just have everybody sit in their chairs because someone fell off the stage last time we did this show, and I'm so scared of that. But also, the fun thing in this space, y'all can hear us just fine. We cannot hear each other. So let's have everybody, when I call your name, come up to the podium, and we're just going to run with it.
Pat, did you see us go like, oh, they can handle walking to and from the podium? You're like, they seem to be doing this okay.
They don't seem wasted enough.
What?
Hmm?
I don't know. I literally don't know what Casey said. I know what Jeff said.
That's all echo.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. It's Echo.
Yeah.
More logistics.
What?
Okay, now I heard you. Great. Cool. So let's have Abby, why don't you come up here and join me? We'll talk about the game we made. Oh, yeah, I get to do this too.
Yeah.
Let's talk about our game, card game, the card game, the video game.
Yes. I have to say I'm proud of it. I think it was a smash hit. Maybe not financially, but we have a good cult following with it.
If and when we get the opportunity to release card game, the video game too, we're going to take what we learned in the first game and we're going to amp it up even more by adding more cards.
Mm-hmm. Yes. I really would love to add in a shuffle mechanic.
Ooh, yeah.
Maybe some sleeves.
Cards are the... Look, we made a card game based on an already popular card game, and then we made a video game version of that because we thought it would sell more cards, but everyone just pirated the video game, which contained all the cards, so we didn't sell anything.
Yeah. I'd like to be mad, but honestly, it's pretty punk rock, and I'm down with
it. Yeah. It's a pretty punk game, and so, like, y'all responded in a way that is pretty great. So I guess what we should say is thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yeah. Lightning round moves fast. Let's have Casey and Laser come up. Yeah. Let's hear about your incredible game, Call of Tony Hawk's Skylanders 2. Ooh.
Finally, we get a chance to say what we were thinking when we came up with this game.
And that's, sorry.
Please.
And that's who here would like to take a full-sized live Tony Hawk and bring him to life inside of your game. Well, for only $149.99 and the cost of a skateboard-shaped Skylanders portal, you can tap him and bring him to life.
I think the most successful part of this game was the streaming experience. Mm. It's the only game that you can stream only in VR and watch only in VR and only if you have like a $3 million setup because you want to see the guy Skylandering all over his skateboard ramps all around your house.
Sure.
You know, you don't want to just see a picture of a skateboard ramp. You want to see a skateboard ramp with a Tony Hawk on it.
And sure, the reviews for this were not great.
No. Oh, God. No.
Mostly they said all that skateboarding in VR made every single reviewer throw up. Mm-hmm. But we stand by the product.
Listen, if it's not making you feel something, it's not fucking art, okay?
Yeah. Holy shit, yeah. All right. Thank you so much. Let's have Dave and Jeff come up and we'll hear about your video game. Let's hear about X2.
Yes!
At last, the sequel to X. Yeah.
Look, man, everyone loved X.
It seemed like, remember that, like 5 years ago, it seemed like we could do no wrong?
Yeah, no, money was, I was pissing money out of my penis, quite frankly.
I was shitting it out of my penis.
Yeah, that's, he had to see a doctor. Yeah. So I had to see a banker. Yeah. X2. I think we overextended ourselves.
I think we need to talk about X1 a little more.
Okay, all right, yeah, all right. If you really want to go there, I thought we had dealt with this, but okay. No, let's talk about X1. Go ahead.
So X1 was a success by any measure, but I think it could have been even better if one half of the creative directing team would have had a little more weight in decision-making.
X1 was a smash financial hit. And, you know, just to postmortem X1 a little bit here, unfortunately, half of the team had to go to the doctor because of a problem shitting out of his penis.
You ruined X2!
X2!
You ruined it!
We have a patch in the works that is going to fix everything
sure.
That people
listen.
Don't like
hey,
about...
Hey, let's ask them. Okay, so X2, I had this fucking vision for what I want to do in X2. when you can shoot eggs out of your cock. That's all I wanted the game to be. Whatever else, I don't care. Oh, what did Mr. Prude say? Mr. Prude said,
not everyone has a penis.
Not everyone has a penis, but everyone wants a penis.
All right, thanks so much, guys. I'm gonna wrap, I'm gonna cut you off on that one.
I think we all learned something today.
Whoever sent me eggs too, thank you very much. Casey, why don't you come up here? Let's talk about the game you and I made. We're very excited to do this quick postmortem.
Best year of my life.
On Heated Gamer Moment Pro Streamer 4.
Ladies and gentlemen, that Heated Gamer has a name, and that name is Pat Bear.
Yeah.
We took a man who was out of 10 most days, and through iterating 3 sequels, we were able to bring him to an 11.
People say that there weren't enough heated gaming moments in Pro Streamer 3, and we listened to your feedback, and we induced more heated gaming moments in Pro Streamer 4. Now, you cannot purchase Pro Streamer 4 anymore. It has been pulled from every store, and we admit,
too hot.
It's too good. Like, we know you are not ready for Pro Streamer 4. Someday, it will be appreciated. And someday, y'all will be cool enough and stop acting like you didn't love it.
Pat, I think you're getting a little heated. You want
to No, don't have the budget to make a fifth game. I really want to make a fucking fifth game. No. I don't want to say
because we were so heated earlier.
I know.
If anybody would like to play this, we have made it.
All right, let's fucking finally talk about ducks. Ducks. Let's fucking talk about. No. That's it. Let's go. We're good. Thank you. Yeah. There's no good way to transition when I'm the one talking. It just doesn't work well. We try. Abby, Jeff, would you mind coming up here? We're going to hear about your game. I would love to hear about Super Pretzelvania 4.
Yeah, this is, I think when we conceived of the Super Pretzelvania franchise, it was a very different era, you know? Malls reigned supreme, pretzels like were just available all over
and
the place.
Angie Ann was queen, and yeah. We were happy to ride those coattails.
Absolutely. And so Super Pretzelvania 1, I think, did really well. 2, not as much. 3, I think we came back. And
yeah,
you know,
we added cheese sauce, so.
Yeah. Super Pretzelvania 4, the big new feature here was the pizza pretzel, because we understood that was very hot. Mm-hmm. And it just, it's not resonating.
Yeah.
If we're honest, no one goes to the mall anymore.
No one goes to the mall and no one eats bread.
No. It's if I had to just, you know, as a postmortem here, kind of just figure out where the pain points really were, it's the people spreading all these lies about gluten. I think that really just smacked a crimp into our sales. It really stood in our way. We tried to get out there. I put most of my take from Super Pretzelvania 3 into the pro-gluten lobby. And we got a lot of good messages out there, but I don't know that it's going to be enough.
Yeah, I think next time we got to target the gluten to the kids.
That's right. We need to get, if the kids aren't going to go to the mall, then we need to bring the mall to them. So for Super Pretzelvania 5, I think it's going to be a virtual mall, mm-hmm. Virtual cheese.
Of course.
And, it's really going to just hammer home that, like, hey, gluten is good. Gluten is your friend.
Hell yeah.
Fill yourselves full of gluten.
Yeah, absolutely.
All right, great, thanks so much. Abby, you can stay up. We're gonna talk to you. Yes, thank you very much. Laser, would you mind joining Abby? We can hear about your next game. This one's a classic. Giraffe Wrangler 2013.
Yeah. Yes. So, big hit.
Yeah.
But the thing about being a giraffe wrangler is the power lines.
It was a lot of the modeling work we put into, first of all, creating our own physics engine, because a giraffe doesn't really work the way you think. Yeah. And then power lines, they don't either.
No. Yeah, we thought that the giraffe center of balance was way wrong.
Yeah, it's in a weird place.
Yeah, it's in the knees.
Yeah. But that's why this game is, frankly, educational.
Yes.
For every person.
You got to wrangle those giraffes. Wrangle. You got to get them in line. It's kind of like a scared straight program, but for giraffes.
And that's true. Actually, most of our sales were to places like schools and other institutions.
Yes. High risk for giraffe crime.
Yeah. Places like New York, Dallas,
Tokyo.
Denver. Yeah, it's, I mean, a lot of...
Ohio.
If you just, if you think about how many giraffe power line disasters you've heard of in real life as opposed to in the game, you know, we've done good work, I think.
Yeah.
If you've played it, talk to us. I haven't talked to anybody who's played it yet.
You out there?
I think kids do at schools.
Yes.
But I guess, I don't know, what was your biggest lesson learned for the next one?
I think that giving the giraffe saddles was maybe in poor taste.
All right, thank you so much, both of you. Thank you. Dave, why don't you come up and we'll talk about the game we made together. It was a joint effort, and we're excited to finally be able to talk about Ninja Explosion 4, Inflammation of the Dark Gods.
We spent a lot of time debating what the actual inflammation would be. Like it could have been just the name of the game, but we spent probably like 36% of pre-pro just debating, is it hemorrhoids? Is it a rash?
We don't know. Somebody in the office wrote it on a whiteboard, and we were all like, this is the name of the game, but why? Like, we all agreed, but then the debate took a long time.
Inspiration comes from the weirdest places.
Yeah.
You never know when it's going to strike or how.
Because like, Ninja Explosions 1 through 3 had no dark gods in them. So we were introducing the dark gods, and it was a clean slate for us.
And we kind of hinted at some inflammation, but we didn't address it directly. So we said, with this one, let's take on hemorrhoids head on.
Yeah. We thought that maybe ninjas had hemorrhoids, and that would be a fun game mechanic.
Yeah.
It isn't. We admit.
Well, no, but if you think about ninja, like, what is it? What, there's ninjas in ninja games.
Yep.
There's salves in ninja games.
Yep.
There's health.
In ninja
there's
games,
treating health.
Yeah. No.
There's
yeah.
all the things you need to treat hemorrhoids, but no one wants to deal with hemorrhoids apparently.
No.
It's a real inflammation that people suffer from. It deserves your respect.
We saw your feedback. There are no throwing stars in this game. There are no enemies in this game. There is no combat in this game. And we'd like to just say right now, expand your...
Oh. Well, that's my bad. That's my bad.
No, that's what I'm feeling. I was going to say something about expand your mind, the possibility of what ninja games could be. But you're right. I
mean, do you remember that one person on Twitter? It was like, hey, I found the one game, the one katana in the game, and it was hanging on the wall. You couldn't even wield it.
Yeah.
It's a game about hemorrhoids.
Yeah. That's
Get over yourself.
That's an Easter egg for YouTube, asshole.
Boom!
Boom. Roasted. Thank you so much, Dave. Yeah. Casey and Jeff, love to have you up here to talk about your game. This one... this was a real barn burner out there on the independent scene. The Great 420
yes!
Bake Off.
Yes, yes, yes.
I would love to talk to you all about the development of the Great 420 Bake Off, but as you might expect, I do not remember most of it.
I did not know what that meant when we started this. I initially thought that this was like, wow, 420 players at the same time? This is going to be tremendous. That's a lot of baking. And
I didn't realize just how much of our budget we were going to blow through on this, figuring out what that meant.
I did.
I really don't like drugs. And so I want to talk to you now, kids.
Do I get a chair, turn your chair backwards?
I just want to get serious with you for a minute. You can be cool and not smoke a reefer. And if you got people out there that maybe you work with, and they're out there telling you, you got to get high on the weeds if you want to hang 10 and shred it up, I want you to know it doesn't have to be that way. Stay in school. Do not play the Great 420 Bake Off. And I want to apologize to parents. We did not mean to get this rated E for everyone.
I did.
All right, thank you, gentlemen. Tough love. Tough love. You got it?
All right.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, great. That's
this chair here.
That's Abby's chair
okay,
now. Great.
Thank you.
Okay. So weird shit has happened in the show. We've never had photographers leave their seats to get into the aisle. That's a new one for us. Laser, would you mind joining me up here? We're going to talk about a game that we worked on together. We're going to talk about Dig Dug 2. Can you dig it? Did we answer the question, can you dig it?
Hey, you know what I think?
What do you think?
You fucking dig it.
Yeah.
You fucking dig it.
Yeah. You told us that you could indeed dig it.
Yeah.
By making this the most successful game on the Apple App Store.
Thank you.
For 3 weeks. Thank you.
Yeah.
I mean, thank you. Thank
you. We worked really hard.
Yeah.
Congratulations.
Most of the work went into the motion controls for dig.
Yeah.
Dig.
Yeah.
And then.
Doug.
I think people have actually found it to be really good for exercise, and also this particular kind of vibration pattern has made it popular for other people.
Yeah, several discords that we had to ask to be invited to were very positive about our game.
Yeah, a lot about the digging in words that I didn't quite understand.
No, I mean, we asked like young people, like, hey, what does this phrase mean? And they just giggled at us, which is a really good sign. Because I don't know what any kids like, but they seem to be pretty into Dig Dug 2. Can you dig it?
It's the new Fortnite.
Yeah. We're telling people it's the new Fortnite. Please, let's that catch on. That would be great for us if that could catch on.
Haven't played Fortnite, but I love Dig Dug 2. Can you dig it?
Yeah.
The people with the highest scores have breasts in their photos, and I don't know why that is.
Like, yeah.
I honestly love it though.
Yeah. Yeah, we discovered a fan base we didn't know existed, and we'll never go back to making games for other people. We are getting so much great feedback from the alpha build of Dig Dug 3.
Yeah.
Oh, you can dig it.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, Laser. Always a pleasure. All right. It's time to have Casey and Abby come up here, talk about the game.
At long last.
Yes, it's time for that. I don't know.
Casey, I'm gonna push you off the stage.
Please don't. But please do talk about your game, Goku's Revenge 2.
Nobody gets that anyway.
Yeah. I did.
Okay, so in Goku's Revenge 1, as you know, he got his revenge. He succeeded in it. So Goku's Revenge 2 is his journey through retirement and giving up violent crime.
And getting just awful diarrhea, as we all know.
Oh, yeah.
Goku's revenge is Japanese slang.
Yeah. His
diarrhea.
The power level of his diarrhea is like 100.
That's how high that goes in Dragon Ball Z, right?
Yeah.
100?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Do we have any anime experts on the panel?
Yes.
All right.
Yeah. He does get married in Goku's Revenge 2. Was he married before, Jeff?
Yeah.
Okay.
But after the horrible divorce he goes through in Goku's Revenge 1.
It was like a side mission. That's not even why he was getting revenge.
It was really depressing. We sold it as DLC and everyone was very excited. They were like, oh, who's he going to fight? Is he going to be Superman? Is he going to be Vegeta?
It's a lot of just in the law with his lawyer crying.
Yeah, just...
eating a lot of cheese stuff, which explains the runs.
The
Yeah. I think it's a hit.
I think so, too.
All right, great. Thanks so much. I don't remember all of these. Some of them like, oh, yeah. And sometimes I'm like, oh, yeah, that one. Jeff, why don't you come up here? We're going to talk about the game that you and I have put together. It's a little something we like to call George Clooney's The Division 2.
I am so excited. As a kid, I always wanted to be able to work on the George Clooney games, you know, in all their forms. And it was a privilege for me to be able to come onto this project and work on George Clooney's The Division 2.
Yeah. I mean, I totally 100% agree. There was a lot of promise in George Clooney's The Division. And it fell to us to take the groundwork that they had done and just throw it all the fuck away.
Yeah.
You know, we scrapped all that shit.
Exactly. You know, we're here to put our mark on the franchise.
Yeah.
So basically, we didn't take any of George Clooney's calls.
No.
He called a lot, which I did not expect, honestly. I thought it was a crank call at first, and then I picked one up and he said, "This is George Clooney." And I said, "Prove it." And then he put Brad Pitt on the phone.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh my God.
Hell yeah. Yeah, it was cool to talk to Brad Pitt.
Yeah. He was eating a candy bar like he did in those movies. It was really crazy.
It was really great.
Yeah. Very high Brad Pitt.
So cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, so hot.
I really hope that maybe at some point we can get onto the Brad Pitt franchise, because I think that I would love to take his phone calls and then promptly ignore them because we're professional game designers.
We know
what people like, and that's hardcore cover shooting mixed with bank robbery swagger.
Yeah.
And I don't need George Clooney's name on it to do that. And I was very proud to not take George Clooney's calls, and I'm very not proud that he's out there taking all the credit.
Yeah. Oh. George Clooney will make you think he did this game by himself.
Oh yeah, no, he was in there, just like I'm adjusting the. You need the time to kill's not right. And I'm like, what does that even mean, George?
Yeah.
He's a garbage dump of a human being.
Yeah.
But I'm proud to have worked on his video games.
Yeah, I'm proud to be part of the legacy of the George Clooney games.
So please, talk about this game on social media a lot, but do not buy it. We would love to be able to pivot this into a Brad Pitt thing, and we have a campaign going in the office, a little Skunk Works effort, where we're like, it's just really George Clooney's name just held us back. We need a bigger star. And they're like, Brad Pitt's not a bigger star, you moron. And I'm like, the fuck he's not.
Yeah. Oh man, Brad Pitt's in Division 3 would be so good.
Oh,
we want to make that game so bad.
I want to make that game so bad. I have so many ideas.
Yeah.
It is gonna. The time to kill is gonna be just right.
I can't wait to make Brad Pitt so mad at us.
Oh, he's gonna hate us forever.
Yeah, forever.
Oh, it's gonna be the best.
It's gonna be great. Jeff, thanks so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. So many of you that retweeted the tweet where I said, "Hey, retweet this and give me your video game names," put numbers in the titles. You may have noticed that every single game in the lightning round has had a number in it, or you didn't notice, and I just did this for no reason. I don't know how many more there are, but at some point there won't be numbers. To see if it's on this one, let's have Casey and Laser come up.
All right.
We're gonna.
That's a lot of suspense.
I shouldn't have. Let's hear about your game. Uncle Buck's Backyard Rumble! We're done with numbers, I remembered.
key weapon in Uncle Buck's Backyard Rumble is, of course, the snow shovel spatula.
It's a snow shovel with the elasticity and lifting power of a spatula. And if you don't pick that as your primary weapon during your first battle, the leveling is just not going to work out
for you. Yeah, you can't win at all.
No.
You have to feed so many small children.
Yeah.
And the pancake size with a regular spatula, it's just not going to work out.
It's not going to work.
It's no good.
You're going to get eaten by the coyotes in front of your children.
And the ones loose in your backyard.
Yeah, the children and the coyotes.
Because they're all hungry.
They're so hungry, and they all have so many crying animations. We actually videotaped real children crying to get it accurate, because we care.
And then we brought that one coyote into the mocap studio,
yeah.
And we're really mean to him.
Yeah.
We didn't hurt him. We just said, like, oh, you're so mangy.
Yeah.
Like, oh.
I found pictures of that coyote from high school, and I was like, what were you thinking?
We told him about the box office results of Coyote Ugly, and he was very unhappy.
Yeah, we negged him.
And then he wouldn't fuck us. It was really upsetting.
All right, thanks so much. Took a movie reference and added another movie reference to it. I fucking love that shit. Let's have Dave Lang and Abby Russell. Let's hear your game. Hot dog save.
Yay.
The hot dog save.
Finally time to talk about this in public,
yes.
Huh? Wow.
The hot dog sage. So many of us have unanswered questions about hot dogs.
Some more than others. My first question was, who puts sage in a hot dog? Turns out not that kind of sage.
No.
Yeah, completely wrong. This is more like...
Like wisdom.
Wisdom. And like, originally, the first thing I came up with for this, because I'm kind of the creative brains in this operation.
Mm-hmm. And I'm the hot dog brains.
Yeah. I was thinking cold calculating business person.
What's the difference?
Thinking. Sure. I wanted like an anthropomorphic hot dog that would just spit hot wisdom at you all day long. But then Abby pointed out, not a game. That's called a TV show.
Yes. And we are in talks with some networks. Hopefully we'll get that on the air as well. But our game, of course, is a sentient hot dog, and you ask life's greatest hot dog questions at it while also fighting crime.
It's like if Seaman was cool and a hot dog instead of a garbage-ass fish in a bowl.
Exactly, yes.
Fuck yeah.
It's
yes.
Just like that.
Yeah, and at the end, hot dog Sage eats hot dogs. So it's really horrifying.
It seems pretty sick, but hear us out.
It is sick.
It's super fucking
it's
sick.
It's fucked up.
Fuck hot dogs.
Yeah.
They're not, you know, you think like, oh, they're cute and they're dancing. It's like same thing as like a cat and a dog. Like you feel like, oh, I have compassion and emotion for this thing now. No one has compassion and emotion for hot dogs. No one.
No one.
Except vegetarians.
No.
Okay, great. Thank you so much. Jeff and Casey, would you mind coming up here? We're going to hear about your awesome video game, Zoot Suit Battle Royale.
Finally, you know, the swing coming back to games. It's been a long time overdue, and you're welcome. We're very proud to be bringing Zoot Suits and just the essence of swing and the real swagger.
Yeah.
Back absolutely. To video games.
Yeah, we personally trained 100 different members of the Squirrel Nut Zippers.
Mm-hmm. Which we wanted more, but the other 800 of them were like, we couldn't find them, honestly. They were in gardening mostly.
Yeah, we trained them. We know that they don't sing Zoot Suit Riot.
Yeah.
But we wanted to make sure that they were combat ready. So we took them to a military facility, dressed them head to toe in pinstripes, got that one giant feather.
Yeah.
And then just gave them AR-16s and let them loose.
Yeah, it was honestly amazing. It was
erotic in a way that I didn't expect.
Yeah, no, I mean, like swing music, it was extremely sensual.
Yeah, definitely, definitely. And, you know, we thought that that would lead to success when trying to make a game that was at least a little bit about combat.
Well, Battle Royale is such a crowded genre. We were like, how can we make our game stand out?
Right. And microtransactions, we were like, okay, we're going to have microtransactions around fucking. Mm-hmm. We're going to have microtransactions around zoot suits.
But yeah, but not neither of those are explicit, though. The fucking's very subtle.
Oh,
the
yeah.
The zoot suit's also very
this
subtle.
This is like Cinemax level of stuff, which maybe, like, in our effort to, like, reach a wider audience, I think we might have actually appealed to a little bit of no one. I think, you know, if we're being honest with ourselves, I think we could have gone a little bit harder.
Well, let's take a quick poll of the audience. How many, raise your hand if you've played a Battle Royale game. Okay, now keep your hand up if you own a zoot suit. That's why we failed.
Yeah.
All right, great. Yeah. Thanks so much. It's good to know the whys. Abby, would you mind coming up here and joining me? We're going to talk about a labor of love, Legend Squat.
Yeah. Or as I like to say, Legend Squat!
And peek behind the curtain, Abby loved to say it like that. Every day,
yes.
That's the start of our work day.
Yes.
Was Abby.
Right, generally, I would come into people's homes sometimes.
Yeah.
Just disgusting.
Very nicely.
Yeah.
So, Legend Squat.
Legend Squat!
It's a puzzle game, and you. You solve legendary puzzles with you and your crew, or squad.
It's a forced co-op puzzle game. You have to play with other people, or you cannot play at all.
Yeah. That was the thing that people were the least excited about, was the forced co-op. Apparently, you guys want to play with your own friends and not people we assigned you to play with. We're like,
it's not called Frank Squad!
No, yeah. We can't make Friend Squad.
Well, we could.
We could make Friend Squad.
Or we could make Friend Squad!
You're not wrong. She's not wrong. She's not saying anything wrong. Look, we tried so fucking hard to make a cool puzzle game.
We put it on the Switch and everything.
Yeah. We announced the game, and the very first response tweet was, Switch when? And we were like, when it launches. And they were like, fuck off. And I don't know why.
Yeah.
It's like, you said you wanted it, and then you didn't buy it on the Switch. No one.
I think we kind of set the tone for them, and by we, I mean me.
Yeah. You were so aggressive about this game.
Yeah.
Legend Squad.
Legend Squad!
Thank you, Abby, yeah. Laser, would you mind coming up here with Jeff? We're going to hear from you about your incredible game. And that game is a little thing called Breakneck Backgammon Bros.
You know, finally, we got our opportunity to merge everything that we both love as creators.
Yeah.
Breaking necks. And brotherhood.
Yeah, and heavy merchandising opportunity.
Definitely. Yeah, this was, you know, you may remember Breakneck Backgammon Bros started out as a very popular Flash animation.
Mm-hmm.
And we were very excited to be able to bring it to an interactive medium. Mm-hmm. And make a lot of t-shirts.
Yeah. As you were saying, the Flash animation had about 15 frames. And so does the game.
Yeah. We wanted to be true to the original.
So you could play it for 2-3 hours, but you'll be looking at the same thing for about 15 minutes.
Yeah, it kind of just kind of flips through them a little bit. Some say it flips through at random, which is not true.
No.
It's a set order.
It's a set.
Yeah,
it's
no matter what you do, it's a set order. And I guess, you know, we went with the alliteration with the BBB.
Yeah.
And I think one of our major failings is Neither of us truly know what backgammon is.
No idea. No idea.
I thought it was a thing you do on a boat.
Yeah. And here's the thing. It may be.
I was told it wasn't, but you can't trust the internet.
No. Our dad heard we were making video games, and he was like, what, like backgammon?
Yeah.
So that's why that's in the title.
I thought that he had, initially, I thought he had made it up. I was like, oh, this is from those dads.
Yeah, I thought it was
like
a word that.
Oh, backgammon. You know, yeah. Like, yeah. He did that all the time.
Yeah. So there's a few DLCs coming out. They just kind of change the color a little bit, like an Instagram filter.
Yeah, we're pretty excited about a couple of them, but not so much the others.
No, it's just, you know, it's our brother. He does the art, and he's very lazy.
He has Photoshop, and we love him.
Yeah.
And we tried to get him to work on a 16th frame, and he said some very rude words.
Yeah.
Very rude words that I won't repeat here. But
get out of my basement.
Yeah. Well. Yeah.
All right. Great. Thank you so much.
Thank
you. So we've got time for one more, and probably way more than that. So I'm going to quickly just show you a bunch of ones that, like, you do. You figure it out. You make jokes
for
yourself.
The home game.
Yeah. The home game. Take this home with you. King of Rain Redemption. The Influencer. That's a good one. On the Other Side of Sweden. I don't know what the fuck that means. Oh No, My Bread, which is the sequel to Who's That Over There? Mastered, Remastered, Horsey Man Returns, The Quest for More Oats, Sensible World of Mummies, Loot Crepes. That one is just a good Twitter joke. That's just like whoever, it's just a good joke.
You can't get crepes in the mail. They don't last.
Here's one that I wish we fucking had time for. Ghost Chuckers, the game where you chuck ghosts. What's the game about?
Chucking ghosts, obviously. Yeah.
Thunder Truckin', who knows? The Yoshi Farm, gross. Laid Back Jousting.
Very sexy.
Sonic the Hedgehog, the movie, the game.
That's just real.
Yeah.
They will make that game.
Fall,
like, don't joke. They will make that game.
It's gonna be for
it's gonna be sexual as hell.
Yeah.
Like every game we've pitched this evening.
Fireboy, Burn 'em All. Michael Transactions, AAA Battle Royale, Schluter of the Week. Is Schluter catching on or
no!
Is it? Oh shit, it is.
No.
Schluter is catching on. Fuck.
It sounds like cleaning out a gutter.
Super Schluter. Marlin Brothers 2. They're not all great. Jehovah's Witness Cat
Damn,
Doorbell Quest. That cat can't reach the doorbell. Dangin' Rompers. That's a half of a Prosy D joke, actually. Poppy's Chair. Fuck, I want to know more about Poppy's Chair. Sonic Verse. And building a fort where we weren't supposed to build a fort, that's the last one we legitimately don't have time for. But it's about building a fort where you aren't supposed to. And guess what? You can't win the game.
No.
There is no winner. Give a round of applause to everyone you see on stage. Thank you so much for hanging out with us tonight. Please come to several people on this panel are going to be in League of Heels Rumble 6 on Sunday, 10:30 a.m. We're in the main theater, so please come. They gave us the main theater again. I can't fucking believe it. So please come. If you like wrestling, come. If you don't like wrestling, come. It works for both somehow. And also doesn't work at all. And I stream, so fuck it. I don't know. Please, I'm unemployed.
Yay,
good night and goodbye. Enjoy the rest of PAX.